Hallelujah and blessings, friends. Welcome back to Haya Kadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life, and Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And together God's people say, Hallelujah. Well, friends, we're continuing our study on the book of 1 Enoch, and today we are going to begin chapter 100. Now, keep in mind, there are only 107, depending on what versions you're reading, 108 chapters in the book. So we are approaching the close of this book very quickly. Now, I have placed the link in the description box below if you'd like to follow along with us. And if you have your Bible, let's begin at 1 Enoch chapter 100. And in those days, in one place, the fathers together with their sons shall be smitten, and brothers one with another shall fall in death, till the streams flow with their blood. For a man shall not withhold his hand from slaying his sons and his sons' sons, and the sinner shall not withhold his hand from his honored brother. From dawn till sunset they shall slay one another, and the horse shall walk up to the breast in the blood of sinners, and the chariot shall be submerged to its height. Now in Revelation chapter 14, verse 20, we are told the winepress was trodden without the city, and blood came out of the winepress, even unto the horses' bridles, by the space of 1,600 furlongs. So the blood will run so deep it will reach the horses' bridles. And Enoch says here in verse 3, the chariot shall be submerged to the height of the blood. And so we see the same image in both the book of Revelation and in the book of 1 Enoch here. And if you've forgotten, since the last time we were together, this is discussing the great battle of Armageddon that will take place at the end of time. Continuing in verse 4, in those days the angel shall descend into the secret places and gather together into one place all those who brought down sin. And the Most High will arise on that day of judgment to execute great judgment amongst sinners. And over all the righteous and holy, he will appoint guardians from amongst the angels. So we will be guarded and protected during this time by the very angels from the throne room of God, to guard them as the apple of an eye. Now we see the reference that God's people are the apple of his eye in Deuteronomy 32:10, Psalm 17:8, Proverbs 7:2, and Zechariah 2:8. And here in the book of Enoch, which was written before these books, again it uses the same imagery, the apple of his eye. And so it appears these great writers of these books from what we now have in the Old Testament were readers and even studied the book of 1 Enoch. It continues by saying, they shall guard them as the apple of his eye until he makes an end of all wickedness and all sin. And though the righteous sleep a long sleep, they have not to fear. Now, do you remember in Revelation chapter 20, verses 4 and 5, keeping in mind that Enoch has stated the righteous will sleep a long sleep during this time. And in Revelation chapter 20, verse 4 and 5, it says, I saw thrones and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. These are those who died during the great tribulation period. But notice verse 5. It says, the rest of the dead, those who had died before the tribulation period, did not live again until after the 1,000 years were finished. This would be the first resurrection. So if you and I were to die today, we would not be present in the 1,000-year millennial reign. The only ones that will be present with Christ during the 1,000-year millennial reign, according to God's holy word, is those who died during the great tribulation period. And it seems that's what Enoch is saying here. Though the righteous sleep a long sleep, they have not to fear. Verse 6, and then the children of the earth shall see the wise in security, and shall understand all the words of this book. This seems to be talking about the book of 1st Enoch. All shall understand the words of this book. Why will we understand them? Because we're going to see them played out before our very eyes. And they will recognize that their riches shall not be able to save them in the overthrow of their sins. Woe to you, sinners, on the day of strong anguish, ye who afflict the righteous and burn them with fire. Ye shall be requited according to your works. Woe to you, ye obstinate of heart, who watch in order to devise wickedness. Therefore shall fear come upon you, and there shall be none to help you. Woe to you, you sinners, on account of the words of your mouth, and on account of the deeds of your hands which your godlessness has wrought. In blazing flames, burning worse than fire, shall ye burn. And now know ye that from the angels he will inquire as to your deeds in heaven, from the sun and from the moon and from the stars in reference to your sins, because upon the earth you execute judgment on the righteous. And he will summon to testify against you every cloud and mist and dew and rain, for they shall all be withheld because of you from descending upon you, and they shall be mindful of your sins. Now this would seem to be speaking of the great drought that's going to hit the earth during the time of tribulation. Verse 12, and now give presence to the rain, that it be not withheld from descending upon you, nor yet the dew when it has received gold and silver from you, that it may descend. When the hoarfrost and snow with their chilliness, and all the snowstorms with all their plagues fall upon you, in those days you shall not be able to stand before them. Chapter 101. Observe the heaven, you children of heaven, and every work of the Most High, and fear ye him, and work no evil in his presence. If he closes the windows of heaven, and withholds the rain and the dew from descending on the earth on your account, what will you do then? Again, the great drought that is coming. And if he sends his anger upon you because of your deeds, you cannot petition him. For ye spake proud and insolent words against his righteousness. Therefore you shall have no peace. And see ye not the sailors of the ships, how their ships are tossed to and fro by the waves, and are shaken by the winds, and are in sore trouble? This should remind you of the language spoken of by James, chapter 1, verse 6, when he says, let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. Or Paul in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 14, where he says, that henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine. And Enoch says, do you not see the sailors of the ships, how their ships are tossed to and fro by the waves? And so the comparison is given that we're not to be tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine, the same way these sailors are tossed to and fro by every wind of the sea. Enoch continues in verse 5, therefore do they fear because all their goodly possessions go upon the sea with them, and they have evil forebodings of heart that the sea will swallow them, and they will perish therein. Are not the entire sea and all its waters and all its movements the work of the Most High? And has he not set limits to its doings and confined it throughout by the sand? And at his reproof, it is afraid and dries up, and all its fish die, and all that is in it. But ye sinners that are on the earth, fear him not. Has he not made the heaven and the earth, and all that is therein? Who has given understanding and wisdom to everything that moves on the earth and in the sea? Do not the sailors of the ships fear the sea? Yet sinners fear not the Most High. Chapter 102. In those days when he hath brought a grievous fire upon you. Now again, remember, we're talking about the end time, great tribulation, specifically the battle of Armageddon. And Enoch says, in those days he will bring a grievous fire upon you. Could this be what Zechariah chapter 14 verse 12 is saying? When it says, and this shall be the plague wherewith the Lord will smite all the people that have fought against Israel. Their flesh shall consume away while they stand upon their feet. Their flesh will melt while they're standing there. Their eyes shall consume away in their holes. Their eyes will be melted in their sockets. and their tongue shall consume away in their mouth. So will their tongue. That's how great the heat from this fire will be. Now, this could be a fire sent by the Lord upon the earth, or this could be referring to nuclear war. And so Enoch begins chapter 102 with that question. In those days when he has brought a grievous fire upon you, whither will you flee? And where will you find deliverance? And when he launches forth his word against you, will you not be affrighted and fear? And all the luminaries shall be affrighted with great fear. And all the earth shall be affrighted and tremble and be alarmed. If you'd like to better understand this, simply read the book of Joel. And all the angels shall execute their commands and shall seek to hide themselves from the presence of the great glory. And the children of earth shall tremble and quake. And you sinners shall be cursed forever. And you shall have no peace. But fear ye not, ye souls of the righteous. And be hopeful, ye that have died in righteousness. Now this could be speaking to the fact that the righteous will be present during the Great Tribulation, which goes against everything that most Christians in Western culture have been taught. Or it could be speaking to those who become righteous and receive the Lord Jesus as Savior, King, and Master during the time of the Great Tribulation. I'll not speculate. In verse 5 he continues, grieve not if your soul into Sheol has descended in grief, and that in your life your body fared not according to your goodness. But wait for the day of the judgment of sinners, and for the day of cursing and chastisement. And yet when you die, the sinners speak over you. As we die, so die the righteous. And what benefit do they reap for their deeds? This is what the sinners will say about the righteous. What have they benefited by living good upon the earth? They die just like we die. Behold, even as we, so do they die in grief and darkness. And what have they more than we? From henceforth, we are equal. And what will they receive? And what will they see forever? Behold, they too have died. And henceforth forever shall they see no light. I tell you, you sinners, you are content to eat and drink, rob and sin, strip men naked, and acquire wealth and see good days. Have you seen the righteous, how their end falls out? That no manner of violence is found in them till their death. Nevertheless, they, the sinners, perish and became as though they had not been, and their spirits descended into Sheol in tribulation. Now remember, in the Hebrew, Sheol is the place of the dead, the grave, what is called hell in the New Testament. Now that might confuse some of you, but you have to remember in the New Testament, there are two words for hell. Well, actually three, Gehenna, Hades, and Tartarus. Tartarus is only used for the destruction of the fallen angels. Hades is the place of the grave, and Gehenna is final judgment. No one is in Gehenna at this point. All are in Hades. But in the King James Version of the Bible, most often, the word hell is used for both Gehenna and Hades, which is what causes the confusion. And so those who die in unrighteousness, the sinner in the day and age in which we live, going all the way back to the very beginning of man, right now they are in the grave. They're not in heaven. They're not in hell. They're in the grave, either awaiting judgment or awaiting reward. Chapter 103. Now therefore I swear to you, the righteous, by the glory of the great and honored and mighty one in dominion, and by his greatness I swear to you, I know a mystery. And I've read the heavenly tablets, and I've seen the holy books, and I have found written therein and inscribed regarding them that all goodness and joy and glory are prepared for them, and written down for the spirits of those who have died in righteousness, and that manifold good shall be given to you in recompense for your labors, and that your lot is abundantly beyond the lot of the living. And the spirits of you who have died in righteousness shall live and rejoice. Again, it says you shall live. Why? Because you're asleep in the grave right now. That's what we read back in chapter 100 and verse 5 when it said, the righteous sleep a long sleep. We have dealt with this in other videos, and there are many passages both in the Old and New Testament that give reference to that we are sleeping. We are not dancing on the streets of gold in the city of heaven. not as of yet, friend. And so back to verse 4, the spirits of you who have died in righteousness shall live and rejoice, and their spirits shall not perish, nor their memorial from before the face of the great one, unto all the generations of the world. Wherefore no longer fear their contumely. And contumely simply means disgrace or humiliation. So no longer fear the disgrace that comes from the mocking sinner or the humiliation that they throw our way. Woe to you, you sinners, when you have died. If you die in the wealth of your sins, and those who are like you say regarding you, blessed are the sinners, well, they have seen all their days, and how they have died in prosperity and in wealth, and have not seen tribulation or murder in their life, and they've died in honor, and judgment has not been executed on them during their life. Know ye that their souls will be made to descend into Sheol. So it doesn't matter how prosperous or how wealthy they were in this life, what awaits them is great torment and suffering that will last throughout eternity. And they shall be wretched in their great tribulation, and into darkness and chains and a burning flame where there is grievous judgment shall your spirits enter. And the great judgment shall be for all the generations of the world. Woe to you, for you have no peace. Say not in regard to the righteous and good who are in life, in our troubled days we have toiled laboriously and experienced every trouble and met with much evil and been consumed and have become few and our spirits small, and we've been destroyed and not found any to help us, even with a word. We have been tortured and destroyed and not hoped to see life from day to day. We hoped to be the head and we've become the tail. We have toiled laboriously and have no satisfaction in our toil. And we have become the food of the sinners and the unrighteous. And they've laid their yoke heavily upon us. They have had dominion over us that hated us and smote us. And to those that hated us, we have bowed our necks, but they pitied us not. We desired to get away from them that we might escape and be at rest, but found no place whereunto we should flee and be safe from them. And our complaint to the rulers in our tribulation, and cried out against those who devoured us. But they did not attend to our cries, and they would not hearken to our voice. And they helped those who robbed us, and devoured us, and those who made us few. And they concealed their oppression, and they did not remove from us the yoke of those that devoured us, and dispersed us, and murdered us. And they concealed their murder, and remember not that they had lifted up their hands against us. Chapter 104. I swear unto you that in heaven the angels remember you for good before the glory of the Great One. And your names are written before the glory of the Great One. Be hopeful, for aforetime you were put to shame through ill and affliction, but now you will shine as the lights of heaven. You will shine and you will be seen. And the portals of heaven shall be opened to you. And in your cry, cry for judgment, and it will appear to you. For all your tribulations shall be visited on the rulers, and on all who help those who plundered you. Be hopeful, and cast not away your hopes, for you shall have great joy as the angels of heaven. We shall have great joy as the angels of heaven. If that don't want to make you shout hallelujah, friends, I don't know what will. What shall you be obliged to do? You shall not have to hide on the day of the great judgment, and you shall not be found as sinners. And the eternal judgment shall be far from you for all the generations of the world. And now fear not, you righteous, when you see the sinners growing strong and prospering in their ways, be not companions with them, but keep afar from their violence, for you shall become companions of the hosts of heaven. Do you remember when David said in Psalm chapter 73, verse 12 through 17, behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. Now, I said David, let me apologize. This is actually a psalm of Asaph. But what he's saying here, he's saying, my righteous living is vanity. There's no reason for it, because as I look around me, it is the wicked and the ungodly that prosper in the world. It is they that increase in riches. I'm not prospering. I'm not seeing riches, says Asaph. He says in verse 14, all the day long I have been plagued and chastened every morning. I'm living a life of discipline for no necessary reason. But then he says in verse 16, when I thought to know this, it was too painful for me until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I understood their end. I saw their end. And so it's not about what's acquired in this life. It's about what is acquired in the life to come. We may suffer greatly in this life, but the riches and rewards that await us, that's what we're working toward. And that's what Enoch seems to say here in verse 6. He says, do not fear, you righteous, when you see the sinners growing strong and prospering in their ways. Do not be companions with them, but keep afar off from their violence. For you shall become companions of the host of heavens. And although you sinners say, all our sins shall not be searched out and be written down, nevertheless they shall write down all your sins every day. And now I show unto you that light and darkness, day and night, see all of your sins. Be not godless in your hearts, and lie not and alter not the words of the uprightness, nor charge with lying the words of the Holy Great One, nor take account of your idols. For all your lying and all your godlessness issue not in righteousness, but in great sin. And now I know this mystery, that sinners will alter and pervert the words of righteousness in many ways, and they will speak wicked words and lie and practice great deceits and write books concerning their words. These would be the books of false doctrine, friends, false religions, the Book of Mormon, the books on evolution, the Quran, and other such writings. But when they write down truthfully all my words in their languages, and do not change or diminish aught from my words, but write them all down truthfully, all that I first testified concerning them, then I know another mystery, that books will be given to the righteous and the wise to become a cause of joy and uprightness and much wisdom. Could this be speaking of the Bible? The books of the Bible? And to them shall the books be given, and they shall believe in them and rejoice over them. And then shall all the righteous who have learnt therefrom all the paths of uprightness be recompensed. If this is speaking of the Bible, it says it will cause us much joy, and that it does. It will give us the words of uprightness or righteous living. It will impart to us wisdom, and they shall believe in them, and they shall rejoice over them. And then all the righteous who have learnt from these books, all the paths of uprightness will be recompensed. I'm not saying the Bible or the books of the Bible is what Enoch is referring to, but it certainly seems that's what he's speaking of. Well, friends, we're going to end there today. And just to give you a small teaser, I'm praying about and considering which of the next two books we're going to discuss. Should it be the Book of Jubilees or should it be the Book of Jasher? Both are mentioned by name in the Bible. And that's why we want to take a closer look at them. And it is my prayer that those studies, as well as the study of the book of 1st Enoch, will bring us much joy in our journey as we travel to the celestial city and give us wisdom, courage, and strength as we fight the battles here to get there to that city. I can honestly tell you that I am a different person of sorts from the study of the book of Enoch, and I truly pray that you are as well. Now, I love you, friends, as Yahweh wills, and until next time, I'll see you on the next video.